praise the Lord, everybody. Welcome to our sit-up spiritual impact training using prayer and scripture. I'm Pastor Tony Burke Brown. I'm coming with our word today for our spiritual workout, our spiritual exercise. You know how it works. We join together at 6 a.m. Eastern Standard Time for prayer in the morning. If you've not yet done it, check the information underneath this YouTube video. But then you can come on here and get your word for the day, Monday through Friday, so that we are able to get into this word. You take it back and do your spiritual workout. You meditate on this word. You find other scriptures to connect with it, and then you begin to meditate on it. Read around the verses with all you're getting. Get understanding so you can grow, so you can change, so you can progress, and so you can be impacted and make an impact. And so we do our spiritual workout. I have our word for today. And don't forget also, when you want to follow the sit-ups, you can hit the subscribe button and the bell and get notifications when I upload the videos. And also, if you need a little boost in preparing for your spiritual workout, there is a sit-ups ebook available, and the link is underneath this YouTube video as well. Please note that that is not a physical book. It is an electronic book, an ebook that you download on your electronic device, your phone, your tablet, your laptop, and so forth, with an e-reader. So, with all of that said, let's get to the word today. Get your pen, pencil, highlighter, paper, whatever you need so that you can write down these scriptures, highlight them, and go back and do your spiritual workout. I'm going to give you the appetizer. You're going to go back and get the meal. And so this is what we're talking about today. Equipped for the work. Equipped for the work. You have been equipped for the work. You know, we have a purpose. There is an assignment for you. There is a mission for you. And many times people miss what it is God has called and purposed them to do in the ministry, in their walk, in their life, because of fear, because they feel like they're not equipped enough. They don't know enough. They don't have enough resources. They don't have enough people backing them, enough people believing in them. But I want to encourage you today that God has already equipped us with everything that we need in order to fulfill what he's called us to do, because this is a faith walk. We walk by faith. You may not see what you need, but God has already given you what you need. And so again, the just shall live by faith. The Bible tells us walk by faith, not by sight. And so you want to know that you know that you know God has equipped us. Everything that we need is available to us, but we have to start taking the steps. So we're going to look at this word equipped. One of the definitions that I want to look at is actually the one that we find in Ephesians chapter 4, verse 12. But in that particular verse of scripture, it says perfecting. But it means to equip. What this means is a preparing. It means bringing to a condition of fitness. Now, remember, we're doing our spiritual fitness, our spiritual workout, our sit-up, spiritual impact training using prayer and scripture. It is bringing us to a condition of fitness so that we are perfected, so that we are equipped, so that we are ready, so that we are able to do what God called us to do. Also, it says exact adjustment, which describes how enables the individual parts to work together in correct order. Again, Ephesians 4 and 12, when it talks about, you know, the pastors, preachers, teachers, you know, the thing is that we, you know, don't go to church building so that we can have programs and events, but it's for the equipping of the saints, the perfecting of the saints, to do the work of the ministry. And so even as we're studying the word and worshiping and praising it, this is to equip us to do what we've been called to do the work of the ministry, to be used by God for his purposes, to be able to go forth and do the good works that we were recreated in Christ to do. So let's look at some of the verses of scripture. Again, write them down so you can go back and you can meditate on them, read around them, get the full understanding, and then connect to some other verses of scripture. The first verse of scripture that we're going to look at is in Hebrews chapter 13, verse 21. And it says, equip you with everything good that you may do his will, working in us that which is pleasing in his sight, through Jesus Christ, to whom be glory forever and ever. Amen. I forgot to mention, I'm reading this from the ESV. Okay. The English Standard Version. You always go back and read your King James. I'm reading this just for the sake of time to give you a plain version, a plain English version. You go back, you connect it with the King James, and you read them both. But what this is saying is that he equips us with everything good that we need to do his will, so that we're able to. So whatever his will is for you, whatever the ministry, whatever the call, whatever the purpose, whatever the assignment, he equips you with everything good so you can do his will. We're without excuse. Even when he tells us to be holy, to abstain from even the appearance of evil, that's his will. He equips us to be able to do that. We're going to look at that. But the thing is that whatever he's told us to do, whatever he's instructed us to do, whatever he's called us to do, he has equipped us to do it. It says, working in us that which is pleasing in his sight, through Jesus Christ, to whom be glory forever and ever. Amen. So he's given us what we stand in need of. 1 Timothy 6 and 12, write these down. 1 Timothy 6 and 12 says, fight the good fight of faith. Take hold of the eternal life to which you were called, and about which you made the good confession in the presence of many witnesses. Fight the good fight of faith. So now we're called to fight the good fight of faith. We're to walk by faith. We are to live by faith. This is what the word tells us. So you're like, well, you know, maybe you're thinking, well, you know, I need to work on my faith. I don't have that much faith. You know, I have faith in this area, but, you know, I'm having trouble in another area. And when we think about faith, what we need to remember is that God gives us all faith. We're not without faith, right? And without faith, it's impossible to please him. So if we're thinking, well, you know, I know without faith, it's impossible to please him, but I don't really have that much faith. I don't really know if God can do this. I don't know if he's going to do it. Look at Romans chapter 12, verse 3. Romans chapter 12, verse 3. We need faith in order to accomplish God's will. So it tells us, and to be pleasing to him, because Hebrews 11, 6 is where it tells us without faith, it's impossible to please him. You can't walk in the will of God without faith. You can't walk in the purposes of God without faith. You will have to trust him. Know his word is true, that his son died for you and rose from the dead, that God has a plan for you, that you're fearfully and wonderfully made, that you, you know, you are, you know, able to do all things through Christ. You can do all things through Christ who strengthens you. You have to believe that. So in Romans 12 and 3, it says, for by the grace given to me, I say to everyone among you, not to think of himself more highly than you ought to think, but to think with sober judgment, each according to the measure of faith that God has assigned. God has given you a measure of faith. He's given you a measure of faith. Now we exercise that faith, just like we're doing these spiritual workouts, the spiritual fitness, because remember, this word equipped is about us being brought to a place, a condition, right, of fitness. And so when you exercise your faith, it grows. It's just like trying to get muscles. You have to work out in the gym. You have to lift the weights. You have to, you know, you have to use the equipment that you've been given. And we've been equipped with equipment so that we can exercise our faith, so that we can get to the condition, right, of, you know, of fitness that we need in the spiritual, so that we are walking bold and we're walking with zeal and we're accomplishing the things God called us to, and we are being perfected and we're being changed and we're walking in this faith where we are witnesses and we're effective and we're a light and we're the salt and we're ambassadors. The word tells us to be these things, and God equips us to become these things. The word tells us to do these things, and God equips us so that we are able to do these things. And then we want to look at, let's see, what other verses of scripture do I want to go to? Because you have to find some for yourself. 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verses 3 through 5. Again, I'm reading all of these from the English Standard Version. Go back and read these in the King James, meditate on them, and whatever other version you feel comfortable with, the Amplified version, it fine-tunes a lot of the verses. It has a lot of extra words, but it gives you a lot of extra meaning. 2 Corinthians 10, verse 3 through 5, it says, for though we walk in the flesh, we're not waging war according to the flesh. For the weapons of our warfare are not of the flesh, but have divine power to destroy strongholds. We destroy arguments and every lofty opinion raised against the knowledge of God, and take every thought captive to obey Christ. So now look, we have been given spiritual weapons. It says we're walking in the flesh, but we are not waging war according to the flesh. We don't look for the guns and the knives and the cussing and the fussing and the fist fighting. And we're not fighting against flesh and blood. It's a spiritual battle. The weapons of our warfare are not of the flesh, but have divine power to destroy strongholds. So we're getting rid of those arguments, those things that imaginations, the things that come against the knowledge of God, the word of God. And we take our thoughts and captive to obey Christ, to obey the word. And so we've been given this power. We've been given this measure of faith. We've been given God's word. We've been given spiritual weapons, prayer, praise, word. And we meditate on it. We use it, the sword of the spirit. We use it. It's all the word of God. And when we're meditating on the word of God, we're taking our thoughts captive to obey Christ, to obey the word of God. And when we're doing that, we're automatically fighting. We're automatically waging war against the enemy, because to obey and submit to God is to resist the devil. When we're doing what God says, we're automatically fighting against our fleshly lusts and desires. When we're doing what God says, we're automatically opposing the ways of the world, because the word and the world oppose one another. The spirit and the flesh are contrary one to the other. So when we're led by the spirit, walking in the word, we're killing the flesh. We're standing against the wiles of the devil. We are able to oppose the things of the world and stand for righteousness. This is how we wage war. We're not fighting people. We're fighting spiritual wickedness in high places. And so then 2 Peter 1:3, 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 3, write it down. This is what it says in the English Standard Version. And I know sometimes it seems like I'm going fast, but you know you can hit pause while you go and find the scripture. Amen. And so it says, his divine power has granted to us all things that pertain to life and godliness through the knowledge of him who called us to his own glory and excellence. His divine power. His divine power has granted to us all things that pertain to life and godliness. Listen, through the word of God, through knowledge of the one that called us, right? This word gives us everything that we need. This power, this strength, this boldness, this zeal. What we need, what to pertain to life and godliness. There's no excuse. When we read the word that says, be holy for I'm holy. When people are, you know, bringing forth the word and talk about walking, you know, according to God's will and godliness and holiness. And then we're like, well, I'm not perfect. Only Jesus was perfect. I can't do that. I'm not able to overcome this. Yes, you are, because you've been equipped. You have been given this power on high. You have been given what you need that pertains to life and godliness. It's available to us, but we have to want it. We have to seek it. We have to embrace it. We have to do our spiritual workout. We have to exercise this word. We have to apply it. And so we have been given everything that pertains to life and godliness through the knowledge of him that called us to his own in excellence. We have to know him. We are to be conformed into the image of Christ. So the more we become to know him, the more we become like him. And so 1 Corinthians chapter 12, I'm only going to give us a couple more, and then you have to go and do your own and find your own. 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verses 4-7. And it reads, now there are a variety of gifts, but the same spirit. And there are varieties of service, but the same Lord. And there are varieties of activities, but it's the same God who empowers them all in everyone. To each is given the manifestation of the spirit for the common good. Again, there's a whole lot of different gifts. There's, but it's the same spirit. There's a lot of different services, but the same Lord. There's a lot of different activities, but it is the same God who empowers us, who equips us, who enables us, who perfects them all in everyone. This is how the body of Christ works together. This is how we come together and we are able to walk in the power, the authority, and the light that we are called to be effective witnesses, because God empowers us. And the Bible tells us the Holy Spirit gives us gifts as he wills. So each of us has been given gifts, talents, abilities, as the Holy Spirit sees fit, as we are able to handle it. And when we begin to operate in that, we're already empowered and equipped. We've been given a measure of faith, given God's word. We've been given knowledge, wisdom, understanding. The more we seek him, the more we find him, the more we study, the more we understand. The Holy Spirit lives on the inside of us. He is our teacher and our guide. He reminds us what we've learned and what we've heard. So we have a teacher. We've been empowered by the Holy Spirit. Jesus gave us power over to tread on serpents and scorpions and over the power of the devil. We have been given the word. We have been given the word of knowledge. We have been given everything that we need. We've been recreated in Christ Jesus unto good works, according to Ephesians chapter 2. And so let me just go to at least one more. Let's see. There's so many. Romans 8 and 31, just write that down. It says, what then shall we say to these things? If God be for us, who can be against us? That is one thing that you want to remember as you are going forth to do the will of God, as you're walking in your purpose, as you're walking away from some things that have bound you up. Remember this, if God be for you, who can be against you? And the word says God will never leave nor forsake you. He will always be there because he's God. He's the same and he is faithful even when we've not been faithful. You can walk away from him, but he hasn't left you. So it tells us again in Romans 8, this time looking at verse 37, no, in all these things, we are more than conquerors through him that loved us. We've already been made more than conquerors as we are walking in Christ, abiding in him and walking in the word. As we are walking in the love of God, the faith, as we are trusting in him, we're more than conquerors. Things are going to happen, but no weapon formed against us shall be able to prosper. Right? We have been given power and authority that we can stand against the wiles of the devil. We have armor. He has given us the whole armor of God. He says, put on the whole armor of God in Ephesians chapter 6. Look at the weapons of warfare. Look at the armor. He's already given us what we need that we can stand against the tricks, the craftiness of the enemy. We have been equipped already. And then it tells us we can cast our cares on him because he cares for us in 1 Peter 5 and 7. So we don't have to carry the burdens and the cares around with us because what's impossible with us is not impossible with God. So we can cast over and toss off and throw off our cares onto him who is able to do exceeding abundantly above all that we ask or think. We don't have to worry. Okay. And then James 1 and 5, that's going to be the last one that I go to today. James 1 and 5 says, if any of you lacks wisdom, let him ask God who gives generously to all without reproach, and it will be given him. If you need wisdom, you say, I don't know how to do this. I don't know where to do this. I don't know where to go. I don't know what to do. I don't know how to make this come to pass. Ask God. If you lack wisdom, ask him. Ask in faith. Ask believing. And he'll give it to you liberally. Why? Because he wants us to walk in his wisdom. Not the wisdom of the world, but the wisdom of God. And we know that the wisdom of God is Jesus. He is the word. And so listen, there's so many more verses of scripture. I want you to go and find some that remind you that God has equipped you for this great work, for the purpose, for the plans. He has equipped you to walk holy, to walk godly, to be spiritually fit. He has equipped you for everything that he's instructed you to do. Because we're even reminded that the word of God is alive and powerful and sharper than a two-edged sword. We're reminded of the things that the word does for us, and we're reminded that it is God breathed. We are reminded that this word, it is in 2 Timothy 3, 16 and 17. Again, I'm reading from the English Standard Version, but it says in 2 Timothy 3, 16 and 17, all scripture is breathed out by God, and profitable for teaching, for reproof, for correction, and for training in righteousness, that the man of God may be competent, equipped for every good work. He's given us everything that we need. You're without excuse. Get busy. Get in this word so you can walk in your purpose, so you can do it with boldness and zeal. Get to the next level. Why? Because God already equipped you for it. He's already preparing you, already perfecting you. God is in control. All we have to do is walk in his will. He's already equipped us. Even when you can't see it, it's already done. We're going to close out in prayer. Don't forget, hit subscribe, hit the bell, share this with somebody who will benefit from this teaching that will benefit from getting a little spiritual food every day so they can do a spiritual workout. Share this with somebody who needs to walk in their purpose and they don't realize they've already been equipped for it. Father, in the name of Jesus, we rejoice. We bless your name and honor you. We thank you for your word and your Holy Spirit. We thank you, God, that you've equipped us for every good work. We thank you, Lord God, for your word, for your Holy Spirit. We thank you for power. We thank you, Lord God, for the measure of faith. We thank you, Lord God, for directing our path as we acknowledge you in all of our ways. We thank you for ordering our steps. We thank you for the angel of the Lord encamped around about us. We thank you, Lord God, for giving us sound minds. We thank you, Lord God, Father, for the work that you're doing in us, that you are purging us, pruning us, removing unwanted elements from us. Lord God, we thank you, Lord God, for continuing to perform the good work you begin in us until Christ Jesus. We give you praise and glory and honor, God, for who you are. We thank you for all that you've done and what you're doing, and we bless your holy name for what you're about to do. It is in the mighty, matchless, powerful name of Jesus that we pray and we say hallelujah and amen. God bless you. Love you to life. I'll see you the next time on the sit-ups.